addicted to the thrill.
I'm ready.
It's a dangerous love affair. Can't be scared when it goes down. Got a problem, tell me now. Only thing that's on my mind is who gon' run this town tonight.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the launch stage, Jason Calacanis.
Wow, what a day yesterday. It was an amazing day. Let's hear it for the companies yesterday. I mean, wow. I would love to take credit for it, but the honest truth is an event like this rises and falls with the quality of the companies. And if you thought we front-loaded the conference and yesterday was all the good companies and today you're going to see duds, it's the exact opposite. Today, we've stacked the deck. We're starting with some of the best companies that we had out of the 600-700 who applied. The first company especially is going to be awesome. And we've got awesome judges, as always. Mo Koyfman is from Spark Capital. We're on the board of GDGT together. You might know Spark Capital because they have investments in companies like the Twitter.
The Twitter.
They're also in the Tumblr, but they were one of the first investors in the Tumblr. What else? There's like five other huge ones. Give us a couple.
What else are we in? Boxy.
Boxy, yeah, that's a good one.
What else folks will find interesting? Consumer. We're in OMG Pop.
OMG Pop, yeah.
We're in Supply, which is a new social shopping startup.
See, you always know the good VCs when they don't rely on their archive of all the good companies, when they promote the newest investments. Very smart. Well played.
Thank you, sir.
Cyan Bannister is a prolific angel investor. You've got to be in 30 or 40 companies now. How many companies have you invested in the last two or three years?
Right now we have 20 in our portfolio.
20. Yeah. So that means you're angel investing in about 10 a year or
Correct.
So. Greg is from Tagged, which you may know is it larger than MySpace now?
Almost.
Almost. social network that is booming and just like slowly growing every year.
Yep.
Everybody knows Kara Swisher is the host of the D Conference, which is undoubtedly the best conference in the technology industry today. It is the gold standard that other conference producers aspire to, and it's now in its next year will be the 8th or 10th?
Ninth
year.
Yeah.
Amazing. And some of the most amazing moments in the technology industry on stage. Steve Jobs and Bill Gates on the same stage together.
Yeah.
What a magical moment.
Yeah, the green room was better.
I'm sure it was. Really, thanks for coming. I know you've got a lot to do. Kevin Rose, one of my oldest friends in the industry, creator of Dig and angel investor in many awesome things. Gowalla. What else are you angel invested in? Foursquare, a bunch of stuff.
Injimoco, Twitter, Facebook, Formspring, whole slew of them.
Awesome. Injimoco would be your big exit.
That was my first exit, yeah.
Congratulations on that.
Thank you.
And of course, Aaron is here from Mint, which won TechCrunch 40, the first event we did many years ago, 4 or 5 years ago now. Yesterday, how many times was Mint brought up on stage yesterday? 10? It seems like when anybody says amazing designed product that was presented in an awesome fashion, it was your presentation at TechCrunch 40 over the Palace Hotel that comes up. And you, of course, sold the company for $8 billion to Intuit. So slightly less, but I think it was $200 or $300 million.
Right? I heard that analysis yesterday that it should have been worth $8 billion. But very pleased that we've set the gold standard in design.
Yeah, and also for presenting. Let's just get right into it. And by the way, if you want to vote on the company, simx.secondmarket.com. This worked really well yesterday, and a couple of folks won an Apple TV. Nick, who was watching on the live stream, won one. Sunil Kandari, Derek Dodge won one, and Ranveer Gujarol. And they won for buying shares of Stack Exchange, Zep, Hipmunk, and Shoot. So you'll win an Apple TV if you're a part of the voting today. Please welcome to the stage an awesome, awesome company. Some people are calling it the Hipmunk of hotel rooms, Room 77.
Good morning. Well, I can't tell you how excited I am to be here to finally be announcing the launch of Room 77's public beta. This is an idea that I've been thinking about and working on in one fashion or another for about 8 years. Has anybody here ever gotten a really crappy hotel room? Isn't it crazy the amount of time and energy and places we can go to research and book a hotel room, but you don't know whether or not you got a good or a bad room until you open the door? At Room 77, we think it shouldn't be a crapshoot. We're building the first database of all hotel rooms and a platform around it so that you know before you go what rooms to request and which rooms to avoid. Let's check it out. Let's say we want to go to Hawaii this morning. Specifically, we'll go to the Hyatt in Waikiki. You're going to see a search results page here that's unlike anything you've seen in the travel space. On the left-hand side, we've literally stack ranked all 1,230 rooms in this hotel according to a set of preferences. In this case, we've set a default set of preferences, a high floor, view is really important to me, put me a long way away from the elevator, and I don't want a connecting room. But obviously, you can go in and change your preferences, and we'll reorder the rooms according to those different sets of preferences. On the top right is actually the view that we've created from room 3907. So click around on the different rooms, either on the left or on the map below, and the room view changes. We've literally plotted the longitude, latitude, and altitude of every room in our database, over 425,000 rooms and growing every day, and created a synthetic view that, as this slide will suggest, one of our alpha users last week who was staying in room 704 at the Hyatt in Cambridge sent us this. This was the view that we created. Below is the view that he took with his actual phone. So at scale, we've produced views from every room in all the hotels we've covered, which is over 2,500 hotels and over 425,000 rooms. On the bottom right, you'll see the actual room map that you can zoom in and out of. And at the bottom of the page, we've literally talked to the bellman and the concierge in all these hotels and given you the tips in case you don't have a default set of preferences about which rooms to request. But some might say, well, why does any of this matter? Aren't all hotel rooms created equal? Let's say in this hotel we wanted to stay in a deluxe ocean view double. My wife and I, we fly across country 10 hours. We show up. If we show up in this room, my wife's going to be pretty happy. But oftentimes you show up at the hotel, deluxe ocean view double, and this is the view from the room. You can get a little bit of the ocean over here, but then you're, you know, this is one of those classic moments. You went to the front desk. They said, yeah, it's a great view. You get to the room, and it's a lousy view. You may have checked in a little late, and now there's no chance to change that room.
2 minutes.
The reality is all rooms are not created equal. So why don't we get behind the scenes a little bit and check out how the foo is made. So this is our content management system. You can see we have over 428,000 hotels. So I'm going to pick one, the Mandarin in Miami. Just get kicked off. So the artifacts that we're sourcing for these hotels can literally range from something the hotel is providing to us, like a schematic, or a picture of an exit room map, or literally a map that you're tracing at the hotel. So a lot of people asked early on, how can you get the hotels to participate in this? The reality is many of the hotels are now claiming their content because they see the power of this as a merchandising platform. But even if they're not, we can literally create the same experience on the front end with simply a picture of an exit room map or somebody going into the hotel and drawing the map. Once you have the information, you can go back to the page and request, you know, click on request a room. We walk you through, coach you tip by tip how to get that room. For example, don't call the reservation center because they have no ability to allocate a room. You have to call the front desk. Don't call 3 weeks ahead of time because they haven't started releasing rooms. Call 2 to 3 days ahead of time. Don't ask for a single room. We've given you 4 or 5 rooms that you ought to choose from. So it's empowering you with the information you need to get the room that you want. Exciting to us is we're now talking with hotel companies, and within the next few weeks, we'll pilot test something where you can actually pick the room and guarantee it. So think of pick a seat on an airline. The aisle seat, the window seat. People are willing to pay $10 extra to get the aisle seat or get the window seat. So who wouldn't be willing to pay $10 extra to get the actual room with the view, $39.12, as opposed to looking at a window after flying cross country? And while we're excited about the basic platform here and its ability to change the way we interact and request rooms, one of the use cases we think is even more powerful is the ability to engage people in an activity they're already doing. People are walking into their rooms today, they're taking photos, they're uploading them to Flickr, but they're not actionable. So how do we engage that audience and allow them to build on top of this base platform? So we're also pleased to announce today that as of midnight last night, our iPhone app has been added to the Apple Store and approved. And Kevin, who runs the business day-to-day, is gonna take you through the use case on the mobile device and how we think that will also change the game.
And I'm gonna do this in 1 minute, so if we could go to the Elmo real quick, that'd be great. There we go. So let's say I'm staying at the Larkspur Hotel Union Square. So now you're in the moment, you're standing in line at check-in, and we think the element of surprise is completely overrated when you're being assigned a room. So I just type in my room number, room 204. And it tells me instantaneously whether I should take it or leave it. If it's a red match based on my preferences, I just want to see alternatives, so I click on the category. I'm going to see some better choices, and now I can have that negotiation with the front desk and have a better stay. When I get up to my room, I'm going to want to rate it. So I encourage you all to download the app today, check out your hotel in San Francisco, write a review, take a photo. If you find a hotel that's not in our database, you can help us by sleuthing the property. There's a feature that encourages you to take a picture of the exit floor map on the back of your door. Thank you very much.
Boom! Boom! Boom!
Wow. Immediate reaction from the panel.
Why is it called Room 77?
Okay.
So I literally had this idea about 10 years ago. My background, I've been in online travel for over 10 years, both as an investor and as a CEO of an online travel company. And the idea was I would go to these hotels and I would just keep notes in my BlackBerry about good rooms and bad rooms. And then friends started hearing about this room list that I had and said, hey, would you send me the room list? I'm going to Miami and I want to know the list of good rooms. And so the experience was I was at a resort in the Caribbean and there was, you know, I was kind of checking out the good rooms and bad rooms. We had been given an average room, but there was clearly a room that was better, and it happened to be named or numbered room 77. And it was just a classic moment. We were there for a week. Had I had the information, had I had the power to call ahead of time and negotiate on my own behalf, we think we would have ended up in that room.
So do hotels like this or not like this?
So I would say this, 18 months ago, so we have a group of angel investors who include the guys who founded Expedia, and Rich Barton said to me early on, none of the hotels are going to give you the content. We weren't able to show in the content management system, but literally we just put a stake in the ground. And we sent.
By the way, that's what Rich said about the hotel rooms originally.
Exactly. So we put a stake in the ground, we went to the hotels, and we just started taking pictures of exit room maps and building this. And we waited until we had a critical mass, and then we went back to the hotel companies. We said, here's what we're launching. So we hope to announce, or actually we did announce today, a partnership with one of the largest hotel companies in the world, where they're now claiming and verifying all their content. So much like you see on the places pages on Google, where the hotels are claiming their content, and they're using it as a merchandising platform. They understand that transparency is going to happen, so they better embrace it. But clearly, there are lots of hotels who say, we'd rather this not happen. The good news is the business model does not depend on the hotels giving us the content.
So it's a fee for leads, is that correct? Is that your?
Yeah, so the business model really threefold. For people not particularly familiar with kind of online travel vertical, it's about a $40 billion vertical. TripAdvisor is about a $4 billion business. three principal ways we think this will be monetized. Number one, providing high-quality leads to everybody in the ecosystem, from the hotels to the OTAs, et cetera. Number two, we talked about driving ancillary revenues. So the pick-a-seat model represents about 6% of the revenue now to the airlines. So the ability of people to both upsell themselves, both across categories, because they now have more information, and to pay $10 or $15 extra to guarantee that important room in Hawaii, we think is a no-brainer. The hotels are willing to share that revenue. And the third piece is, every hotel company we've shared this with, the first question out of their mouths is, can you open up the API? Can we buy this data? Can we license this data? We need this data on our own website, because it empowers us to get people into the room we want. You're shaping the demand on the front end. I was an investor in ITA software. That was one of the really smart moves that ITA did early on. By opening it up to the airlines actually gave them content that nobody else had. So we think by opening up, we may actually get content.
So yeah, I have one question as well. Yeah.
Right. I was just saying, so they could make a business of the crappy rooms too? I mean, that they could say,
you'll get
a discount or something?
I think one of the important things is that this is not an editorial engine. It's a preference-based engine. You set your preferences. So some people want to be on a low floor next to the elevator. It's not my preference, so that's going to show up red according to my preferences. Mm-hmm. But my mother, who wants to be able to get out of the hotel quickly, that would be her preference. So the hotels get over that because they realize it's all according to our preferences. We're not making an editorial judgment.
So one question I had, I'm going to South by Southwest in a week.
Yeah.
And I don't care about the view.
Right.
I just want to go in. I know I'm going to stay at the W. It's going to be a decent room.
Right.
Why would I use your service?
Yeah. First, I would say that not every use case will be applicable. There are times where I'm going to be in a hotel for 5 hours. I don't think I would use the service. But if I'm going to South by Southwest, I'm going to be in the room for an extended period of time. The certainty of knowing, A, that I'll be able to get in and out of the room pretty quickly because it's on a lower floor, close to the elevator. I may not care about the view, but when I'm at conferences like this, I don't want to be a mile away from the elevator. And all else being equal, totally agree, you may not particularly care about the view, but all else being equal, if we reduce the friction enough, why wouldn't you prefer a good room over a bad room?
Can you show me where the Wi-Fi works? Because that would be awesome.
Yeah, no, that's when you start thinking about the platform, I mean, one of the most powerful things, and our alpha users are already doing this, they can submit that content. And now we can append it to the specific room. So if somebody says the Wi-Fi sucks in room 2922, but it's number 800 review on TripAdvisor, it's never actionable. But if you could see that in context while you're checking in, and they offer you 2922 and it has horrible Wi-Fi, you say, no, that room's not going to work.
Let's take a question from the grand jury.
Hi, I stay in hotels.
Can we put up the wireless mic?
Hello. There you go. I stay in hotels about 200 nights a year. So I know this problem. And quite honestly, if you stay in a Hilton or a Hyatt, the rooms are always pretty good no matter where. But here's the problem. I would suggest you go after cruise ships, because in cruise ships, you're not spending a couple hundred dollars a night. You're spending $7,000, $10,000, $15,000. And the difference in rooms on cruise ships is dramatic. On the same floor, two rooms over, the boat is hanging down in front of you, the emergency boat. Two rooms over, you have a beautiful view. So I'd recommend you do it for cruise ships.
Mo, what did you think?
The one thing I would just say is, I think people today underappreciate the dramatic differences between rooms, even at Hyatts. I stay at the Hyatt in Seattle every 3 months, and the room next to the elevator that's an executive suite with a lousy view isn't as good as the room facing Puget Sound that's a long way away from the elevator. No, Hyatt.
Yeah. Hey, Brad.
Okay, let's take another
couple. Just a couple questions.
Yeah.
On the supply side, can you take us through how you're getting the supply, what the process is, how scalable it is, and whether you think you need ubiquity on that side to really meet the consumer needs?
Right.
And then on the demand side, how are you interacting with the other parts of the hotel choice equation? So, what room I want to stay in, it's where do I want to stay, where do I want to
right.
go, et cetera. Are you trying to replace the TripAdvisors of the world? Are you augmenting them? Can
right.
you talk about just the supply and demand here?
Great questions to go quickly. In terms of the total addressable market, we're only focused on 3-star and above on a global basis. We think that's 25 to 30,000 hotels and 5 million rooms. We have 2,500 hotels and approaching 500,000 rooms today. That's all been sourced by ourselves. Now hotels are literally sending us files of thousands of hotels at a time. because we've seeded the database, if you will. And the third leg of the stool is going to be consumers sleuthing hotels that we're not going to get to. Second question, just in terms about how we're interacting with the TripAdvisors, how we think we
how
fit
you're
in
traffic, really.
Yeah, absolutely. So we're in talks with all the major search players, all the OTAs, TripAdvisors, et cetera, about distribution. They all see this as completely unique. Expedia, TripAdvisor, they have no idea how many hotels are in the Waikiki. They have no idea which ones face the water and which ones face the city. Their databases stop at the hotel level. And so for them, this is really important and powerful information. For us, we think that, you know, over the course of the next few months, you'll see us roll out innovations like destination-based search, price-based search. Imagine seeing the price of every room superimposed on the hotel. So now in context, you can understand, is that room worth $20 more or $30
more? Let's get another question or two in. Thank you for the concise answers.
So I kind of worry that this has like an antiviral element, like SeatGuru. I don't even want to say the name out loud, especially not at a conference, because if you ever try to book a flight now, it corresponds one-to-one with SeatGuru's good seats and bad seats.
Right.
So do you see that working against you in any way, that people are actually not going to want to share this because that's going to make it worse for them in the long run?
Right. I understand where it's coming from. What's been surprising to me is as we've scoured the web, we understand this activity is already occurring. People are already sharing this information on TripAdvisor and Twitter and Flickr, and you know, they're uploading. The first thing they do is walk into a hotel room, take a picture, and upload it. It's uncanny.
Sure.
And so I think that, you know, that was a concern I had early on. I shared that view with respect to SeatGuru, but you know, that's not the facts that we're seeing as we've crawled the information on the web.
Okay, let's hear it for room 77. Okay, we're gonna keep dropping bombs here. Here we go, Lockify. This is another awesome, awesome, awesome one. All right, let's hear it for Lockify.
I have to start by just thanking Jason and the whole launch team. The launch experience up to at least this moment has been excellent. Bad things happen when sensitive communications, be that financial information, legal, passwords, you name it, end up in the wrong hands. Compromised accounts, websites, identities, privacy law violations resulting in stiff fines and other penalties, and PR nightmares. Unfortunately, today's encrypted communication systems all require a frustrating combination of registration, software installation, and the coordination of keys. You might be able to get over these challenges, but in most cases, your less savvy recipient will not be able to. This is why we created Lockify, the simplest way to encrypt and share information, as easy as using a URL shortener. And like a URL shortener, it creates a link that you pass on to your recipient. Everyone knows what a link is and knows what to do with it. So let's take a look. As a startup, we, of course, frequently have to share sensitive information, sensitive financial information. Just the other day, I had to send Chris our new account password, a financial account and PIN. Obviously going to be very careful with this. I just pop it into Lockify at the top there. The link automatically expires after 3 views or 1 day. You can change that if you want, but that's fine for this right now. The link is going to be essentially unguessable, but it could be intercepted, and for that reason, we recommend offering another layer of authentication. Our authentication methods have all been designed so they don't require any pre-coordination communication between the two parties. So, for example, you could ask the other party a question. Where did we have lunch yesterday? Or maybe something better like, what was the exact amount of the last invoice? Using Gmail in OAuth, if I know the recipient's Gmail account, I could merely put that in, their address, and they would be required to log on to Gmail in order to authenticate. Today, though, I think I'm going to use our latest method, which is phone-based, using Twilio and Tropo. I merely type in the phone number, be that the cell phone or landline, for my recipient. And with that, I lockify. Kaboom! There's the link. And it really is just a link. You can share it any way. You're not tied to any sort of communication system. Email, SMS, chat, you name it. So I send this over to Chris. He clicks on it from his email. He ends up here, says, yes, I trust Jack. And now he's queued to enter his code, or rather to enter his phone number. And immediately he's offered the choice of either having the one-time code texted to him or phoned. He chooses text. In a couple minutes it'll show up on, or a couple seconds it'll show up on his phone. He enters it. Decryption just happened right there on the client. Thank you. You can see there's that big orange button there. That's by default. We give the recipient the choice to delete the, to early expire the link right then and there for security purposes. Chris does that, done. Later that day, I come back. I just want to make sure he got it. I go to what's called the Lockify log. It's where I can see all the links I've created. There it is. And right at the top, I see Chris's link. It's in red because he's expired it. As long as I'm in here, I look at my other links. Hey, that second one, I can see they already viewed it, and that's sensitive stuff. I think I'm going to early expire that too. Done. Okay, so right now, we just showed you all Lockify working in our app. Lockify is a lot bigger than that, though. It's API-based, and we'll be making that public soon. And so, if you run any sort of site and want to use the Lockify API, for instance, let's say you have a CRM system where you're frequently sending out sensitive account information, you hit our API, you Lockify that information, and it's delivered securely. All right, want to show you two more features that are coming out this spring, Lockify Me and File Support. Lockify Me is for companies that are frequently receiving sensitive information from their customers. And believe it or not, we've made it even easier than the regular Lockify. The company merely pre-configures this page and puts in how they want to authenticate. They then put a badge on their website or blog or whatever that says, need to send me sensitive information. You can imagine lawyers, financial advisors, and angel networks all doing this. So here we have Lockify Me for Open Angel Forum. Lockify is officially starting our fundraising today. We'll be going to Open Angel Forum and Angel List, and we would love to see this sort of functionality in the future. Some of the angels have asked us for some of our very sensitive future plans for the next 18 months. And so we enter them, we attach the file here. Push one button, a link is created, it's automatically only able to be authenticated by Open Angel Forum. We send it to them using their usual methods. And so with that, we are Lockify, and we're the safest way to safely send sensitive information. Thank you very much.
Awesome. Let me ask my judges, what did you think about a secure version of Twitter/Bitly? WikiLeaks in a box. What is it?
Worried that it would be a small market size. So how often will the average person need to use a system like this, and why will they use it out of the flow of the regular working day in email and other tools?
Right. Well, let's start with businesses, because this is primarily aimed towards businesses. And as you're probably aware, there are huge compliance regulations that are really sweeping pretty much all the industries. And now they're even going more horizontal with that. 38 states now have customer data privacy laws. Massachusetts has some of the stiffest, and it's believed federal laws will be passed soon. You're not allowed to send around customer information more than one piece of identifying information at a time. So this would be a perfect sort of use for that.
So you would white label it? Is that you would like as a service to companies, or there's just something in there?
Oh no, absolutely.
I mean, it could be part of a bank thing, but I wouldn't necessarily go to it.
this could absolutely, we're primarily targeting businesses. There is a free version, both for individuals and businesses, and we think we'll get a lot of distribution through that as well. Because one of the key things with secure messaging is exposing the end users to it, gaining some level of familiarity with it.
Can you give a specific use case where a business would be sending something that they need to encrypt individually as opposed to, you know, having an encryption system more generally for data that they're sharing either internally or through whatever trusted vendors? I mean, I'm trying to get a sense of like the one-off case where a business is sending something that they want to encrypt on the fly through a third-party service.
You know, attorneys are doing it every day. Contracts, all manner of legal documents. Some of the more savvy ones or more attentive ones are encrypting it now, but the user experience with those systems is pretty rough if any of you have actually used them.
One of the things I'm concerned about is how do you see this being really defensible? I mean, I could throw a developer at this and create Cryptify and have it up in a month and a half.
I completely agree. That was my next question as well.
Yeah, I think the simplicity probably doesn't do justice to the technology that's happening underneath. And this is a security project, and you don't do this stuff lightly. We've been at this for a while. We've talked to a lot of the leading security experts. There's a lot of innovations here. We have patent pending. I understand what you're saying based upon seeing how simple it looks. It's much more complicated, and if anyone wants to talk technically offline, we'd be happy to go into it.
So I don't have a question, but I have a comment. My background's actually in information security, and I actually really think this is pretty cool.
Thank you.
And I actually send credit card data a lot to people, and I end up SMSing it, so I think it's a pretty useful tool
right, to
be able to do that, and it definitely takes away the pain from having to use PGP keys. So thanks.
Right, yeah. No, thank you. Yeah, PGP keys can be truly painful for everyone involved.
Okay. Oh, damn.
I was watching this. I see a almost bigger market opportunity in marketing, right? If you can distribute a link and say, hey, you know, sign up for this and it expires today. And yep. So you click the link and after, or, you know, the first 100 people to follow this link will get a free pass to the launch conference or whatever. That to me seems like a much larger market opportunity, much easier to monetize. The security feels very nichey. You got to win over almost every user. It's not incredibly viral in that, you know, they're very closed loops. If you get a law firm, you might have some success in getting it to trickle out further because every lawyer uses it. But I mean, did you think about applying it to different verticals besides just secure information?
It's really geared towards secure information, and you certainly could do the use case you just described. I don't know if it properly leverages the security aspects. That would be an application I could see someone pretty easily replicating if it's not secure like that. To give you a sense of how big we think the market is, let's say that 1% of all the communications that are occurring in 5 years are of a sensitive nature, stuff people really don't want existing on other people's machines and whatnot. Through our API, through our platform, we think we can capture a pretty big percent of that, literally trillions and trillions of messages. And becoming the Twilio, becoming the Simpo Geo for encrypted communications is one of our goals.
Are you encrypting this data, or what are you doing on the back end at a high level?
We are encrypting this data. We are encrypting, the current application encrypts it locally. The encrypted data or the key, you choose which one, is uploaded to our server. These others embedded into the link and then passed on to the recipient. So we cannot decrypt the data if we wanted to. And that's where a lot of the complexity comes in.
Yeah, but that analysis of the market, not to be passed here, overlooks one point, which is most security is as strong as its weakest link. So the vast, yes, there are cases of the government, WikiLeaks, things of that nature, where it's very important that security is maintained at all levels. But in your average contract or whatever, you know, security is sort of important, but you know, the end machine, the end user, So I do think there's a huge opportunity when you look at marketing in other markets for the same technology.
Right, but to your point, it's sort of important. It's actually very important to people, but it doesn't quite overcome the hurdle of the difficulty of using the current tools. Give somebody a much, much easier tool, and they'll realize, I can get over that, and now I really can protect this info the way I should.
Quick straw poll of the audience. How many people have sent something like a social security number, credit card number, et cetera, over email in the last year? How many people felt nervous about doing so? Okay. So there is a market. I don't know if you'll get it, but really great product, and thank you for sharing it. Let's hear it for Lachlan.
Excellent.
Thank you, Jason. Thanks a lot.
Okay, we're off to a strong start. The Q&A sessions are going long. Let's bring up FTW for our gamers in the audience. FTW for the gamers in the audience.
All right. I'll move this over here. All right. Thank you guys so much. Let me get this sucker rolling. Cool. My name is Mark Bursteiner. We're going to talk about FTW. Gamers in the audience, you're going to want to pay attention. This is a cool little thing that we created for gamers who just cannot stand to lose. You've all done it. It really, really sucks. So really quickly, audience participation. Need your help. Judges, too. Show of hands. Who plays Angry Birds on their iPhone? That's a lot of people. Of course you do. Who plays Angry Birds on their iPad? Correct. People at home watching, too. Hands up. Put down the chips, Pringles, whatever you're eating. Hands up. I can see you. Okay? Who plays on both? You have both an iPad and an iPhone. More than you. Come on, hands up. That's right. So each and every one of you, when you started playing on iPad, started your game all over again then, didn't you? Right? Hands up. I started my game all over again. Wow. That's dedication, right? That takes a lot of time, and Angry Birds is a very difficult game. Wouldn't it be really nice if you didn't have to start every video game that you ever played all over again? I mean, Netflix knows where you left off in movies. RDO knows where you left off in songs. Kindle knows where you leave off in books. Audible knows audiobooks. You wouldn't start reading a book all over again, would you? Just because you got off the train, that's what bookmarks are for. Well, we think we fixed this problem for video games everywhere. It's called FTW, as soon as it clicks over. The way it works is we're an API. We work with developers. Developers bake it in, and they can actually transfer data from the game, regardless of whatever device they're on, to our cloud, and then bump it back down to any other device, whether it's the same one or not. And since it's synced, it's also inherently backed up since we're handling that data already anyway. Okay, so let's take a quick look at it in action, actually doing some stuff here. Let's switch over to the Elmo if we could. Amazing. So I actually have been playing this game. I don't know if you guys have ever seen it before. It's called Tic-Tac-Toe. It's pretty cool. So these are the buttons. These are the calls that the developers can make. We made this game just as a little dummy so that we could show it, and it's obviously not connected to the network, of course. But it's a pretty fun game. You play X's, you play O's, you get three in a row, and you win. It's pretty cool stuff. And what you'll actually see is once we're connected, let's put that on just for some stuff that's pretty to look at. So once we're actually connected, you'll see we'll make some stuff here. There we go. So let's synchronizing. Fantastic. Very cool. And let's find the game over here. And we'll save that state. You see that little spinner? We're connected here. Let's hit restart and restore. Of course, that's it. And we got to, of course, quit the game. And you'll see syncing, restore. There we go. Same stuff. Make some two more moves. Save it again, quit this one. And this is all just demoing each of the calls that the developers are able to make. This is not how it would actually work inside of the game. But we wanted this here so we can actually show each of all the functionality. There you go, there's the exact same moves again. So the way that actually works is actually pretty, like we can switch back to the slides now, thank you. The way that actually works is pretty scientific and geeky. It's kind of hard to understand, so I don't want to bore you guys with that stuff. All you really need to know is that for a developer to roll their own syncing system would take about 140 hours. And about $100 an hour, you're spending $14,000, and that's not even platform agnostic. That's just on one platform at a time. Or you can integrate FTW, spend about 8 hours per platform, and save yourself a ridiculous boatload of money. And it,
honestly, you'd rather be spending more time on creating more games than creating more features for the one game. And the best part is gamers don't even need to log in to each and every game. They only need to log in once per device. So we're actually launching today in private beta. You can head over to getftw.com and sign up. We are looking for developers. We want to work with you. We want to work with your games, and we want to work with your platform. So we are looking to hire you as well. And if you head over, you'll see right now we work on iOS. But pretty soon, in about a month, we'll work on Android. About a month after that, we'll work on Nintendo DS. And then we got to tackle the PSP, the PS3, Xbox, and so on and so forth. We are actually so small that we would love your help in reaching out to developers. So if you head over to the site, you'll see there's an evangelize page there that will help you in reaching out to all the developers. This is what we're looking to hire. So of course, come and find me if you work on any of these kinds of platforms. And we, of course, are looking for investors as well. So please, if you've got some cash, I would love to talk to you. And that's FTW. What we envision is that soon what you're playing will be completely independent from where you're playing it. Because no matter where it is, you can't lose. Thank you guys so much.
OK, Kevin and Tara, so that you guys.
Do you have an arrangement with Angry Birds? I mean, you mentioned Angry Birds at the beginning, but that's not one of your
games.
Are
we working with them?
Yeah.
We've been speaking with them. We've been speaking with them for about a month or so, and hopefully being here will bump us up on their priority list. They're very busy with the Rio game.
But you needed popular games to make this
absolutely
useful.
So that was
in any way.
I kind of brushed past it. The evangelize page on the site, I went through the trouble of creating mail to links for each and every contact form for all the popular games. So if you guys go to getftw.com/evangelize, we're relying on the gamers to actually reach out to the developers to let them know that this is a feature that they want and need.
That they want in the game. Because, you know, yep. XOXO is not the most riveting game.
Oh, no. Well, I mean, I think it's thrilling, but of course.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think this is really cool. I just worry that it's a bridge solution.
Mm-hmm.
And at some point in the not-too-distant future, sort of the ability to sync across multiple platforms, mm-hmm. will be table stakes.
Yeah.
So, you know, do you worry about that? Do you really think you can build lasting value here, or is it just a point in time solution?
Absolutely, because I mean, as far as we see it, OnLive is the next kind of big thing. I don't know if you guys have seen OnLive. It's a cloud-based gaming platform. So everything exists on the server side. All you have is this tiny little box, and all your button presses go to the server, right? That we don't see existing for realsies in actual houses for a very long time because bandwidth in the U.S.
Did you
is
just say for
trash.
Realsies?
I did say for realsies,
okay.
Yes.
For realsies.
cool, I'll meet you at the malt shop later, Archie.
The bandwidth in the U.S. sucks. So that's a problem with that. And even once the bandwidth is amazing, you still have, it's not like Xbox is just going to go, oh, well, on live, you win, you're right. We're still going to have platforms that we're going to, it's still going to be platform exclusive games, all kinds of stuff, and users are going to be playing them all.
Do you want to talk about your business model, your revenue model, anything
like that?
Yeah,
so we're
that?
Actually
you didn't mention any of that during.
We're
going to
be free all the way up until we're done with the beta because it's a very touchy subject. We've played with models, but we're not 1,000% sure yet. We're looking at probably charging end users $2 a month or $20 a year, and then giving it away to developers up to a certain threshold once they get popular.
So you're charging the end users?
Both. Yeah, small indie developers get it for free, they do their thing, and then once we actually start to see some traffic, you know, they're actually hitting our servers pretty hard, then we plan to start charging them based on usage.
Shervin, you run a game company?
So I think this is really cool. We have 30 million users.
That's
I'm
quite a few.
Happy to start testing it on some of our games on
thank
iOS.
You.
So.
Thank you.
Awesome. Closing business deals. I like
it. What one suggestion I would make, obviously between Android and iOS and all the other platforms, I think that's really important.
Yeah.
This is one aspect that's really important in terms of, you know, real-time syncing. I would add another layer to this, which would be syncing leaderboards and kind
right.
of a social layer
yeah.
of the
so,
connection. So it's all of it's updated at the same time.
That's absolutely planned. The reason we didn't do it right now is because there are players right now who do it very well, so we decided not to go after them and do our own thing very well for right now.
Awesome. Any other comments from the judges or questions?
The only other thing I'd say is I just really encourage you to rethink the model on this. I think that, you know, when a user pays $2 for a game,
mm-hmm.
they're not necessarily going to want to spend $2 a month just to
sure.
sync that game.
Yep. Fair enough.
Yeah.
And it's totally still, it's very malleable still. We want to see what users, we want to get as much feedback as possible during the beta period.
and just kind of see what they're actually willing to pay. We did a little bit of market research that was very early that people actually said they were willing to pay upwards of $12 a month per month, obviously. Yeah. But
what you're probably going to hear from the angel investors and judges is get a foothold,
yeah.
Make it free,
yeah.
Make it part of people's daily lives,
yeah.
Or weekly lives, part of their workflow, and then figure out the revenue model.
Yeah.
But get to scale first. Get your foothold in this very niche but important space that you've discovered, and then figure it out. Let's
Agreed.
Hear it for FTW.
Thank you.
I think that's pretty much a reoccurring theme. Let's bring out screener.co. This is extremely nerdy. Any financial nerds in the audience? Any day trader? You're going to love this. This is some geeky shit. Oh, hey. How are you? Please welcome screener.co.
So the first wave of innovation in the financial services industry brought stock trading to Main Street with the advent of the online discount brokerage. However, Wall Street's maintained a distinct analytical and data advantage. As you can see from the screenshots right here, the fact set complex terminal above that costs thousands of dollars a month relative to the oversimplified products available to consumers today from Google and Yahoo Finance that strive for simplicity rather than robustness and complexity. Well, our goal with screener.co is to create a Wall Street caliber data and analytics platform for Main Street. So let's jump into the tool. The first thing you'll notice is that our database contains tens of thousands of stocks from tens of thousands of global companies. Unlike other consumer products that are focused only on US and Canadian companies, if you're lucky, we have a full global data set. Also, if you browse the menus, what you'll see is that we have over 1,000 preset screener criteria. And in addition, you're able to create complex composite algorithms and complex composite formulas that let you create your own screener conditions on top of our pre-built conditions. So let's build a sample screen that's relevant to us here. Let's try to find some attractively valued technology companies. So the first thing we're going to do is limit our scope to the technology sector. Next, we want to eliminate micro-cap companies or other very, very small companies from the list. So let's get rid of any company with a market capitalization of less than 10 million and limit ourselves to only those with greater than 10 million market caps. Next, I know a lot of the risk-loving angel investors in this room like companies and are willing to invest in companies that aren't necessarily profitable yet. But for the sake of this screen, let's look at only companies that have positive net income in the most recent interim period. Now, here's where things start to get interesting. What you're able to do is define complex custom formulas for your, as your screener conditions that use our pre-built data points. So you're able to look for companies that have a total revenue per employee of greater than $500,000, even though that's not a built-in indicator within our data set. We have revenue and employees, and you can create the formula of revenue per employee. What this is designed to do is eliminate a lot of the less interesting low-margin services and manufacturing firms from this particular screen. So next, let's look at the valuation metric at what we define as attractively valued. For the sake of this screen, let's set it as an enterprise value to EBITDA ratio of less than 10. A lot of investors use enterprise value to EBITDA as an alternative to price earnings, as it lets you value the underlying business somewhat apart from the capital structure. So current enterprise value to EBITDA is a built-in indicator, and you're able to use it here. Finally, we want to look at the health of the balance sheet, and we want to make sure that the company is unburdened by a heavy debt load. So let's use a pretty conservative screen and make sure that the total debt in the most recent financial statement is going to be less than their annual EBITDA. Very, very conservative metric. The reason we're not requiring total debt to be zero is in this low interest rate environment, a lot of companies are taking on additional debt to bolster their balance sheets for acquisitions or other strategic opportunities that they may want to pursue in the future. If you happen to be one of those companies, remember, Screener.co is our product, and that's what you're seeing right now. So if we sort our results in descending market capitalization, so we see the largest companies that people are most likely to be familiar with first in the list, you'll see that Microsoft, Intel, and RIM are all prominently displayed in this screen. Now, Microsoft and Intel, as you know, have been posting strong quarterly numbers recently, but their strong duopoly position in the personal computer market hasn't necessarily translated into an equally strong position in the tablet and mobile markets that increasingly representing the future of computing devices. So that may be one of the reasons why they're trading at a bit of a discount. So let's compare the results from our current screen to some other technology companies that people here may be familiar with. Let's try Google, Apple, and Yahoo. And we can create in our stock list view any stock symbols that we want to enter from the data set, in any of the global companies. And once we've added those companies, what we're going to do is use a different view, one of the pre-built views, that looks at valuation, growth, and efficiency metrics. And we're going to change that view in both the results set as well as the stock list view, so that we can compare the companies that were returned by our screen to those that we know about and want to look as a point of reference. What you'll see is that the enterprise value to EBITDA ratio for Google, Apple, and Yahoo is significantly higher than that for Microsoft and Intel. In addition, if you look at the revenue per employee numbers, Apple's revenue per employee at $1.4 million is roughly twice that of Microsoft. Now, if you want to question one of the reasons why they're more highly valued, if you scroll to the right in the stock list view, you can see some of the growth metrics. And you'll see Apple's been posting very strong growth trailing 12 months over the prior trailing 12 months, over 60%, which is incredibly impressive for a company of their scale. Whereas if you look at the growth metrics for Microsoft and for Intel, they're impressive, but not 60%. Unfortunately, we don't have private company data in our data set, but if you were to look at Facebook, for example, at a $50 billion valuation with their estimated $2 billion of revenue, they're trading at 25 times their revenue, trailing revenue, whereas Google even is valued at 14 times its trailing EBITDA, or its profitability metric. There's many more data points in this data set, and the views are fully customizable. So if you want to see more, please stop by our booth. To close, we are screener.co. We are a free public beta until April 1st, and everyone here is welcome to join. And then it'll be approximately $24.95 a month is what we're shooting for. We're running a referral program where you can refer friends during the beta period. If they become paying customers, we'll give you $10. My contact information is above. Feel free to stop by our booth. We'd like to talk with you. Thank you very much.
Okay.
So if this doesn't work out, you can get a job as the fast-talking Micro Machines guy. I'm just saying.
Yeah. In rehearsals, we spent about 80% of our time together slowing down. He's at about 50% of his speed right now. There were twice as many variables covered in the screener demo, and Mark Pesci was there.
Which company am I supposed to invest in?
So one of the things we're deliberately trying to avoid is giving advice. We're trying to provide a powerful platform for investors to run their own strategies and determine what's right for them. In the consumer market particularly, there are a lot of newsletter subscriptions that are offered. So people are selling advice or recommendations. Our goal is to provide the platform and let people make their own decisions.
I think it's useful because I have to figure these little things out on my calculator by myself, unless you buy a really expensive program that you might get, which is useful. And thank you for clarifying the Facebook valuation situation for us. But you would sell to who? Who are you aiming for? Because most big companies have this kind of
data.
Right,
it's not
available
for institutions. It's for sophisticated retail investors. So there was a report put
so
out.
Schwab could offer it, for example, to their...
Right, so there was a report put out that says that about 14% of U.S. households have between 100,000 and a million of investable assets, and 20% of that group are entirely self-directed investors. They make all their own investment decisions. They don't consult professional advisors. So that would be sort of the natural sort of
how would
idea.
You get to them? Through a Schwab
yeah,
or
so
an
it's
E-Trade?
It's a combination of direct marketing to consumer on the internet, as well as partnerships with financial portals, brokerages, and investor education firms.
So my personal opinion, since I started mentioning it's in the space a bit, it doesn't seem differentiated enough from the stock screeners you get for free from even MSN that they've had for 10 years where you can get almost all of these. It's nice that you have equations and some other bells and whistles there, but it doesn't seem differentiated enough. And when we look at our customers, most people, the general population, even the people who have over $100,000 in assets, have difficulty picking from among the 10 investments in their 401k. The way to go in this market is not more complex, it's actually simpler. So if you look at guys like Eggnest.com or Plantly.com, they ask you three questions, like how old are you, how much do you have to invest, and then here's a slider for your risk tolerance so you can see this is how much I might lose if I go too risky, this is how much I might gain, here's my sort of expected return. That's the kind of thing that consumers can handle, and that's the way the industry should be moving. In my opinion, not this way.
I think that's exactly right. I'm worried that you're building a prosumer tool rather than a consumer tool.
Correct.
And in my experience, prosumers almost don't. If they exist, they're almost impossible to find through any traditional marketing channels or otherwise. So I echo that completely.
Do you have any plans at all to make this a little bit more consumer-friendly with tutorials or anything that can bring someone up to speed on how to use these tools?
Yeah, so there's a sales website that's under development right now. Unfortunately, it wasn't able to be released on time. It will have tutorials, forums that people can ask questions in, as well as sort of a direct support ticketing system to answer questions directly if it's not in the forums or the tutorials.
I'd think about a UI solution, and this is kind of to what Aaron did so effectively at Mint, but
you know, there's a lot of powerful data that you're crunching underneath here. How can you present that in a layer to consumers that's far simpler and requires them to make far fewer decisions? Because I think that's sort of the issue for them, is having to make too many decisions, frankly, mm-hmm. if you want to reach a broader consumer market with these with the tool. And
there are a number of companies that are going after that market, several of which were mentioned earlier. I think the objective here was to go after the underserved market, which is the, more of the prosumer segment that you mentioned before.
What if, this is Jason, what if you allowed the prosumer people, which is a small group but a powerful group, to publish their screens on a website frozen in time, so that you could then see 3 months from now, 6 months from now, if this actually resulted in a positive or a negative gain, and just put a comment thread underneath it. So then I could, you know, I'm a geek in that screener, and then you just hit publish, it publishes, and other people could then create a conversation around your thesis and check back on it 6 months from now, a year from now, 2 years from now. So
there is a screen sharing capability built into the tool itself, and that's part of the sales website, is there's a thread created for each one of the included screens so that you can track and discuss it over time.
Yeah, Mark Pesce has a suggestion. He thinks you should meet up with the Hive Trader folks, and then you guys should just join forces, because you've got this incredible prosumer stuff, and they're working on a sort of mint, you know, UI piece. Maybe you guys can work together. Jose from the group has a question about design and how important it is.
Yeah, it's awesome to have Aaron say about the visual. And just the insight I was just going to note in the question, we've been advising actual large banks, and they're into data visualization and looking at what consumers are doing, even at the pro level. How are you going to go to the next step in terms of the UI? Because I think it's definitely very dense.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think one of the objectives was to capture the full complexity in the terminals that's used a lot on the professional side and make it more readily available. So I don't know if we want to oversimplify, as some of the competitors have, just in the interest of making it less complex or more simple. We do want to add more visualization tools to it, though. There are sort of graphing libraries available that we want to integrate so you can view the fundamental indicators both over time and against each other.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
Visualization, not less
complexity. Mm-hmm. Okay. Kara, what's so important on the computer?
Oh, I'm just getting threatening emails from Ariana Huffington for appearing on this panel.
Oh. Hey-o. Here's a little inside baseball. Let's hear it for Screener. Whoa, ouch. Hey, now.
She my legs if I don't step down immediately.
Wow. Ouch. Okay.
I'm a little more manly than Google about the issue.
Oh.
Sorry, Don. I had to.
It's
not Don's fault.
I support the startups at the event who are doing a great job. Let's bring out Stomp.io.
Yeah.
Let's focus on the startups. Yeah.
Okay, so Stomp. Stomp is a social adventure network that helps us find fun things to do wherever we are. Now, I created Stomp because I needed it. I've been working so feverishly on startups for the past 5 years that I actually forgot to live my life. My girlfriend broke up with me.
Aww.
I lost touch with very good friends, and I became, you know, boring and unpredictable. And I want to fix that. I want to help everybody live a bit more adventurously. I want everybody to do things like squirrel fishing. Who here's been squirrel fishing? Anybody? Squirrel fishing is awesome, and it's really easy to do. I mean, all you need is a nut on a string, a curious rodent, and you're good to go. And this is great, because this is a win-win. You know, you're feeding a squirrel after a long, hard winter. We have some fun. And, you know, we just might meet some new friends who share our crazy hobbies. And there are thousands of experiences just like this wherever we are. There's no reason we should ever be bored. The only question is how do we discover them, and how are we doing them with our friends? So let me use myself as a use case. I flew into San Francisco about a week early. I was staying in a hostel, and I met some really awesome people. And we were sitting around a table, bored. So I whipped out my iPhone. Now, the first thing that comes up is fly in a vintage warplane. And this is awesome. I really want to do this. I've always wanted to fly in a biplane over the bay. That'd be awesome, but it's $300. And, you know, there's a reason we're all staying in hostels. But I'm going to add this to my bucket list. Someday I want to do it. So next up is lick a banana slug. Apparently, this used to be used for dental surgery because the poison actually numbs your mouth. And this is a picture of Aaron. Aaron's driving the presentation. Hi, Aaron. Aaron is completely crazy. There's no way I want to do this. I'm going to dislike it. And what we're doing now is teaching Stomp what we consider an adventure to be. I mean, maybe we're a crazy adrenaline junkie, liking taking insane risks. Or maybe we have a family and just want to show our kids a fun time. Now, my new friends and I at the hostel, we were a bit less sane, so we decided to do sumo wrestling. So we walked over to the local sumo store, got these big inflatable suits, went to Golden Gate Park, and actually did it. And it was great. We took a lot of pictures, and a crowd started forming. Other people did it. We kind of spread our joy out. And then we upload these photos to Stomp. So when we upload these things, it's going to do the standard thing. It's going to broadcast out to our Facebook and Twitter friends so we kind of show off how adventurous we are. We're also going to get some points and badges so maybe we can earn some adventure travel rewards. But what I find most cool is that this photo also goes on my adventure log. And an adventure log is like a scrapbook of some of my best memories. When I look at this, I'm happy because I remember what I did and who I did it with. And this is important because Stomp is not just about finding fun things to do. It's really about the people we do it with. That's what makes it special. That's what makes it memorable. And it's my hope that people are going to use Stomp to make lifelong friendships and maybe even to find someone to fall in love with. Because that's what really matters. So one way we connect people is with the plan of the week. This is like an adventure-oriented meetup. We're doing these in San Francisco, Boston, and New York once per week. Our first one is tonight. We're going to meet outside. We're going to be escorted by a limo bus to do indoor wind tunnel flying. Now, normally, these cost money, and the more people who sign up, the cheaper it gets. But tonight, thanks to iFly, they covered 100% of the costs, so it's free. But we only have 24 spots, so if you would like to go, you can sign up at stomp.io. Or you can download the iPhone or Android apps, which are on the app stores right now. Thank you very much.
Wow.
So what do you guys think of love and falling in love and being in love?
It looks like Jackass for nerds. But not that that's a bad thing.
Yeah.
The banana slug, you have a lot of time on your hands. I have small children, so my kids do lick banana slugs, but not adults. How you get? It's like a Groupon, right? Like a kooky Groupon.
I would say it's more like Meetup meets Groupon. It's really about getting people out there to do fun things, and giving them a deal is a good motivator. I mean, if you're like me, I might add go skydiving to my bucket list, but I won't actually do it until one of my friends pesters me to do it, or a merchant offers me a deal to go do it. So you can see we're like collecting crowds to offer deals to, so they actually can do the things they want to do already.
But they have to be wacky, presumably.
Excuse me?
Sort of be wacky and hipster San Francisco.
So I gave the wacky example because I want to be memorable, but you know, you can define what you want an adventure to be. If an adventure to you is going to get the best hot chocolate in the city, that's fine. This will be all user-generated content and curated, and I want a wide diversity from family activities to going skydiving to going squirrel fishing.
Kevin squirrel fishes, so go on, Kevin.
I'll squirrel fish right now.
All right. We'll do it.
He's crazy. He's crazy that. Like that.
He is a nut in a string, Kevin.
That's awesome.
I think the key takeaway here is that whatever you do, your tagline should be is that all you need is a nut on a string.
Oh, that's good. That's a good one. I like it.
So I would do this. I would be a user, absolutely. I do crazy stuff like this all the time. Mm-hmm. But how do you size the market? I mean, how many people are there really out there?
I mean, the idea is to find fun things to do around you. I mean, that's kind of a universal need. I mean, whether you're 40 years old and have a kid and want to do something, or whether you're a wacky 22-year-old college student, it's pretty universal. I would say our sweet spot is people who graduate college when they're no longer immersed in that community and before they have kids. Because there's a lot of discretionary time, a lot of discretionary income.
Yeah, because if you're older, it's someone please watch my child and not to not die so I can sleep, pretty much.
That's that would be my experience. Yeah.
My biggest issue is I actually see this as a feature, and that it would actually be built into other sites like Daily Booth, Path, or Instagram, or other sites like that, so I don't really understand how it's a standalone service.
I see it as the core thing this does, encourage people to get out there and do things by finding fun things around them. Instagram isn't a collection of curated, high-quality things to go do. Neither is Facebook. I guess it could be, yeah.
So do you really see this as like a marketplace for fun ideas?
Yes.
Okay. Awesome. Okay. Oh, Shervin has something to add. He's a nut.
Yeah, how many nuts are there? I think it reminds me of Zosie a little bit. I think you're approaching it in a quirky way, which is great. I think there is a trend for more people to want to collect experiences rather than material goods. And mm-hmm. tapping into that and doing that in a unique and quirky way with your own voice could really work. So I'll go with Kevin. You know, squirrel.
Let's do it.
Awesome.
Fishing.
It's on, baby.
Hold you to it, too.
Now we have something to do lunch. Let's hear it for Stomp.io. Very good.
Thank well you. Done.
All right. Next up, Stork Brokers.
There we go. All right. Ready?
Yep.
Is your mouse working? Okay. So being a parent is freaking awesome, but it does have its little challenges. You don't get a lot of free time, money doesn't stretch quite as far as it used to, and at the end of 5 years, you're left with a poop ton of stuff that you can't even use. So what do you do with all that stuff? You could have a garage sale, but who has time for that? There's always eBay. But again, who has the time and who wants to pay all those fees? Then there's Craigslist. But do you really want Craig's friends to know where you live? So what's a busy mom or dad to do? So my name is Sterling, standing cutely behind the computer is Bridget. And we're here to tell you about storkbrokers.com. So Stork Brokers is a dead simple way to finally sell that garage full of no longer needed baby and kid items. And to prove to you just how simple it really is, let's do a little challenge. So this is Susie and her daughter Ellie. Ellie's now 5 years old, so Susie wants to sell her no longer needed baby car seat. But being a busy mom, Susie only has 2 minutes of free time. And all she has is her iPhone. 2 minutes rules out garage sales. It also rules out eBay. And of course, we know about Craig and his cronies. So, how's she gonna do it? Are you ready to see? And go. Oh, and go. Okay, so first, she whips out her iPhone and logs into the Stork Brokers iPhone app. She then uploads the photo of the product that she took with her phone and the product information, the product name and description, selects the age appropriate for that product that she's selling, and then selects the product category that it can be found in. Some quick shipping info and post. That's it. Did you see it? 32 seconds, Susie's done, back to doing what she does best, being a mom. Isn't it time you cleaned out your garage? Storkbrokers.com, come check us out.
Okay. Thoughts from the panel?
How do you get people using it? I mean, I have tons of crap in my garage like this.
Don't we all?
But how do you get people actually, I just throw it outside for the guys in the caster to take, but how do you actually...
Wow.
Yeah. They take it. Stuff. It's shocking. Yeah, the baby Bjorn was a big, quick, went right 5 seconds. How do you get people to use it? Like, because you want to sell your stuff. You don't want to not sell your... So how do you create a marketplace for it?
Right. And what we do is we basically partner with moms and mom bloggers in particular who just have a huge following of moms who basically go online and share that information with each other. Great places to find deals, great places to find discounts, cool new things that cater to moms and parents.
And in this particular market, everybody's sort of looking for a way to make extra money in the little bit of time that they have. So combining those two together and just promoting and marketing and selling through word of mouth is really one of our main strategies.
Do you have a reputation system? Because, you know, there are crappy, these things get a little wear and tear, and so you can, I don't particularly want to buy something that has many things children
do with things.
You know, like Cheerios crushed everywhere. And so, like, how do you guarantee that it's quality and that people get, you know, not, especially car seats, for example, very dangerous to get a broken one or anything.
Sure. And there is a rating system where you can rate these sellers and compare them. And it's also a community. So it's not just a person, it's not just an email address selling an item to another email address. It's a whole community with people uploading, creating profiles, sharing their vacation photos and things like that. So you can really get a better sense of community and the interactiveness with the community and other moms that are on the site.
So selling a single item still seems like it's too complicated. I mean, why not basically take a picture of everything that you've got by age, you know, 1, 2, 3, and 4. The system parses it all up, and you basically sell it all in bulk, so you don't have to ship individual items. It goes to a warehouse somewhere, and then you can go onto the site and just say, I need stuff. My kid's just turning 2. I need a bunch of stuff. Give me $500 worth of stuff, and I just go around and I pick all the pictures that I want. It's shipped to me in bulk, and that way it's easier on both ends instead of the individual single transactions.
Sure, absolutely. And there is that opportunity as well, where anyone
can
upload items in bulk.
Now is eBay in one vertical with all the network effects. There's nothing, I mean, it's a simpler experience, but everybody knows that eBay is too complex. Everyone knows that Craigslist has a shitty interface,
sure. But
they have the network effect. And so there's nothing unique and special about this that differentiates it. And that would be one thing, for example.
Right, and I do think that a lot of sellers will make that decision. And as we promote it and share it, they'll make that determination to sell things in bulk as well. And you can certainly do that and take a photo of everything that you have and separate it by category or by child's age or age group.
I think that Aaron's point on differentiation is exactly right, but I have a little bit of a different spin on it. I think in order to peel off a category from eBay, and I think Etsy proved this and did it really well, you actually need a community. You mentioned it, but it sounded a little half-baked, you know, like sharing vacation photos, etc. I think you really want to think here about how you get moms and parents connecting with each other, because then you have something that's actually differentiated from just a pure marketplace. Otherwise, you know, it may not be the most efficient channel, eBay or whatever it is, but they have all the demand, so it's a lot easier place to go to. So I'd encourage you to think about, what do you do here to create that community feel that Etsy did so well in
right. This
particular market?
Absolutely.
There's also a lot of shops. I mean, at least I know in San Francisco, you can bring your stuff, drop it off, and they sell it for you. It's not that hard. So it has to be something that's much, much easier.
Right.
Because there's like 6 in my neighborhood, I know. And I bought good stuff there.
I love the suggestion. I think, Aaron, your suggestion included... Check.
I think, Aaron, your suggestion included taking pictures of stuff and having the system say what it is. Maybe take a picture of the barcode, or just like, hey, take a picture of everything, and then stockbrokers
lay it out
categorize
all on the floor
them.
And have the algorithm sort of slice the picture up and center on a particular
or
item.
Or even
that
if
makes
you just had it Mechanical Turked, you know.
And then on the idea of community, I'm not a parent, so this is pure speculation on my part. I would say the ideal thing to do would be find 5 people who have a kid who's basically a year older than my kid.
Right.
And 5 people that I trust that their stuff is kind of quality, it's the brands that I like, it's going to be clean when I get it. And then they bulk sell their stuff, you know, to your system, and then I cherry pick all the things that I need for like that entire year. That's a simple experience to me.
Very good. That's right.
By the way, I'm on the board of a company that has about 1,500 mommy bloggers, and I would be happy to introduce your product to them.
Awesome.
Thank you very much.
We love the, is that EcoMom? EcoMom, great company, and very similar, you know, taking the mommy blogger out, and they're about 2 years ahead of you, so there's a lot to learn there. Let's hear it for Stockbrokers. Well done. Okay. If you guys want to trade these stocks and be investigated by the SEC, you can go to simx.secondmarket.com. No, you will not be investigated. These are virtual currency. And you can vote for which one you liked best, and we'll be showing those results shortly. To my judges, We saw six companies. I'd like you to tell me which one is your absolute favorite and then which one is your runner-up. Room 77, the seat guru of hotel rooms, Lockify, Secure, Twitter / Bitly, easy to use, etc. FTW, game continuation from platform to platform, screener.co, Geeky, screening criteria for stocks, Stomp.io, find love through Geeky Adventures, and Stork Brokers, dead simple way to get your baby stuff on the web and sold. Who's got a favorite? Who's got an absolute favorite? Okay, Greg?
My favorite by far was Hotel 77.
Room 77.
Oh, yeah. Room 77.
Room 77, right. Room 77. Yes. And, okay, the audience seems to agree. And did you have a runner-up in that list?
All the others seem like small opportunities to me. So if I had to pick, I would say Lockify if they made it into an enterprise company.
Yeah, and I think it is an enterprise company with a very easy-to-use front end.
Yeah.
Kara.
Again, Room 77. I think it's. I use a lot of these travel sites, and I'm always angry at hotel front desks to get a better room, and I often complain and get a better room. But I'd like to have more information on travel is really helpful. And I think they could probably sell to someone, actually, I was thinking. Like, yeah. It's not a standalone kind of business. And if I had to say a second one, I think FTW, if they sold really quickly their capabilities of doing that, I don't see it as a standalone company because it's going to be table stakes really soon for a lot of these things.
Maybe get a foothold and then add something.
Just sell to someone.
Just sell. Yeah. Take the money.
Take the money.
Good advice from somebody who's lived through a couple of bubbles. Kevin.
I think that the one that I would actually use probably a couple times a year is Lockify. Like, I think there's certain times you have to send your social security number, you know, private information, and it's simple like Bitly. I don't think it's really a business to me, but it's something that I would definitely use a couple times.
Right. Awesome. Do you have a runner-up, Kevin?
Probably Room 77.
Yep. Okay.
Yeah, Room 77 would be my favorite. It's in a big market. It solves a real problem. They seem to have defensible technology in their proprietary database and the way that they get all the people to enter information about rooms and height of building. So very good. Lockify would be second.
Awesome. Sam?
Room 77 as well. It's something that I've wanted for a long time, but I think that they could branch off into like concerts with seats and ball games and things like that because you never know what kind of seat you're going to get or room. So I think it's
that's
a pretty cool
huge,
service.
Actually.
Huge. Seats
that's,
is a great idea.
Yeah, it's a great idea.
Yeah. And did you have a runner-up?
Lockify,
okay.
So I'd love to be different, but I'm not.
Well, we know that, but which companies?
No, Room 77 and Lockify.
Okay, a very clean sweep. We're going to take a 10-minute break and start right up. As good as those companies were, the next group is just as good or better, so please stick around.